HarperCollins and Harper Audio present The Last Musketeer, Traitor's Chase by Stuart Gibbs, performed by Ramon de Ocampo. Prologue. Madrid, Spain, July 1615. The Alcázar, the royal palace, home to the King of Spain and Portugal, was perched high on a hill above the city. Like the Louvre in Paris, it had originally been built as a fortress, but was currently being converted to a more pleasant place for the royal family to live. Which meant that at the moment, it wasn't really pleasant at all. Despite the blazing sun and summer heat, inside the castle it was dark and cold. Michel Dinicoeur felt it was more like a prison, and he knew prisons. He'd spent over 100 years of his life in one. Michel was immortal. Long ago, he'd had grand plans to gain power and wealth. But things hadn't worked out the way he'd hoped, thanks to the three musketeers, Athos, Porthos, and Aramis, and Greg Rich. It had taken him centuries to recover from their meddling. Now, he had a new plan. One that would not only allow him to get revenge on the musketeers and Greg, but also provide him with even more power than he'd ever dreamed of. Michel followed three guards through a maze of stone hallways and grand staircases until they arrived at the throne room. The decor was as drab as that of the Louvre, but Michel was surprised by the room's enormous size. Stained glass windows allowed some sunlight to spill in, though the room was still so cavernous that torches were needed to fully light it. King Philip III sat on a large wooden throne at the far end. He was only in his 30s, with a pointed beard and a twirled mustache. He wore what was considered extremely fashionable in 1615. Bright yellow stockings, an ornately embroidered jacket, and a neck ruffle so large it looked as though his head was on a platter. Instead of a crown, a feathered hat was perched on his head. The look was supposed to inspire awe, but instead, it made Michel think the man was a fool. Unfortunately, Michel knew his own appearance was hardly impressive. He was dusty and weary from his long journey. His clothes were tattered and worn, and he was an invalid. There was only a stump where his right hand had once been, thanks to Athos's sword.
"Your honor," he said in Spanish as he passed between a gauntlet of armed soldiers and knelt before the throne. "Thank you for seeing me."
King Philip's eyebrows raised slightly in surprise.
"You speak Spanish."
"You are surprised," Michel replied, standing. In fact, he spoke 5 languages fluently and could read and write another 10. When you were immortal, you had plenty of time for self-improvement.
"I didn't think any Frenchman was smart enough to master our language."
The king's statement, though insulting, wasn't really unexpected. Every civilization in Europe thought itself better than every other.
"But the letter I sent you was in Spanish," Michel said, "as was your reply to me."
Philip shrugged.
"I thought there might be a Spaniard helping you."
Michel did his best not to sigh. He had sent the letter with the aid of Milady de Winter, a handmaiden from King Louis XIII's palace. He had intercepted Philip's response en route, which was why he was here right now, prostrating himself before this pompous idiot.
"Do you still possess what I inquired about?"
Philip smirked and reached beneath his silken clothes, revealing a chain of silver links around his neck. He tugged on it, lifting out a large black crystal that dangled from the end. The Devil's Stone. Only one half of it hung on the chain, but there was something entrancing about it, as though it somehow wasn't of the earth. Michel's heart pounded at the sight of it, though he fought to hide his excitement. The stone was the key to his plans. When both halves were combined, it had incredible powers. Long ago, it had given him the gift of immortality. More recently, He had used it to travel back through time, returning to 1615 from the 21st century with a plan to kill the musketeers when they were only teenagers. However, Greg Rich had interfered. Greg was from modern times, and when he and his parents accidentally followed Michel back through time, they caused him to lose the Devil Stone. Now Michel needed to find both pieces again. Fortunately, he knew where they were, as he had tracked them both down once before, back when he had been known as Dominic Richelieu. And yet, while he'd known this half of the stone was in the Alcazar, he hadn't expected the king to be wearing it. Philip seemed to sense Michel's excitement and defensively closed his hand around the stone.
"This must be of great value to you," he said, "to have come all this way for it."
"It is," Michel admitted. There was no point in being coy. If everything went according to plan, Michel would have his half of the stone again soon enough.
"Though its worth is sentimental, not financial. Long ago, my family used to own it," he lied.
Philip gave a snort of laughter.
"It must have been very long ago. This has been in my family for as long as anyone can remember." "Then you come from a long line of fools," Michel thought, "to have owned this for generations and never understood what it was."
But he replied deferentially,
"That is correct, my lord. And you have journeyed all the way from Paris, hoping to get it back." "Correct again."
Philip laughed once more, but longer this time, as though Michel had told a joke.
"Then I'm afraid you have wasted your time. I do not intend to sell this to you."
Michel bristled.
"But in your letter to me, you said you might."
"That was when you were a man of power, a member of King Louis XIII's court."
Philip held the stone up and smiled at it dreamily, as though entranced by it.
"But things have changed. From what I understand, you were ousted from your post in the palace. You are now a fugitive, a traitor, and a pauper. Your only worth is the bounty placed on your head by the King of France. A bounty I am tempted to collect."
Philip snapped his fingers, and his soldiers swung their swords toward Michel.
"So, tell me, what could you possibly give me that could pay for this?"
He dangled the stone tauntingly before Michel. Michel didn't even glance at the swords aimed at his neck. Instead, he kept his eyes locked on King Philip's.
"I can give you France," he said.
Part 1. The Assassins. Chapter 1. Paris. Greg Rich crept slowly through the Louvre, clutching his sword tightly, fearing an attack at any second. Flickering torches lighted the rough-hewn stone walls as he made his way along the dirt floor. A rat scurried past him, no doubt to its burrow between the gaps in the stone, while clusters of bats hung from the high, shadowed ceiling. Although clad in his musketeer's uniform, bright blue with the emblem of the king, a white fleur-de-lis embroidered on it, the chill air made Greg shiver. He was in the oldest section of the palace, a remnant from when the Louvre was a fortress on the western edge of Paris. It was hard to believe this was actually part of the home of the King of France. The bells of Notre Dame chimed in the distance. It was 7 o'clock at night, and although back in the 21st century it wouldn't have been late, here in the 17th, most people were already turning in for the night. The sound of the bells made Greg uneasy. 2 months before, he'd nearly been killed by Michel Dinicoeur in that bell tower. As Greg edged through the dim corridors, he struggled to remain calm, practicing what Athos had taught him. Breathe slowly, be alert to everything around you. Keep your sword unsheathed so you're always prepared for trouble. Bat squeaks and the flutter of wings alerted Greg that someone was approaching from behind. He spun, his sword at the ready, just as his attacker lunged from the dark passage. A blade glinted in the torchlight, clanging against Greg's own. Greg took a swordsman's stance, right foot forward, and parried. Athos's lessons filtered through his mind. Stay in the moment. Focus. No matter how hard he tries not to, your attacker will always signal what he's going to do next. Predict, prepare, and counter. Greg watched his opponent's hands and feet, guessed where the strikes would come next, and responded. They ducked and dodged, steel hitting steel. Still, Greg was on the defensive, forced to back down the passage as his attacker surged forward. But then, Greg saw his opening. He deflected a slash at his head, twirled to the right, and attacked. His instincts were dead on. He had a direct shot at the heart.
Drop it, a voice hissed in his ear.
Suddenly, there was another sword at his throat, cold metal biting against his skin. Greg let his sword clatter to the ground.
What'd you do that for?
The voice behind him asked, far less sinister this time. Greg said. Because you told me to?
Why would you do what the bad guy tells you to?
The sword lowered from Greg's neck, allowing him to face the second attacker. Porthos.
After all, he's the bad guy. He's not looking out for your best interests.
Well, what was I supposed to do? Greg asked. Outduel two men while there's a sword pressed to my neck?
Yes.
Athos, the first attacker, emerged from the shadows.
If that had been Michel Dinicoeur or Dominic Richelieu behind you, your head would no longer be attached to your body.
How do you expect to catch the madmen if you give up so easily?
Maybe you can beat two men in that situation, Greg said, but I can't.
Then I'd recommend not getting into that situation,
Athos replied coolly.
You should always be prepared for an attack from behind, no matter what.
Greg sighed and picked up his sword. Athos was right, of course, which only reinforced the fact that, even after 2 months of training, Greg still felt way out of his league in a sword fight.
Hey,
Athos put a reassuring arm around Greg's shoulders. You're doing great, honestly. If it hadn't been for Porthos, you'd have got me right in the chest.
Yeah, I would have.
Greg mustered a smile.
I almost did you in.
Oh, I wouldn't say that.
Athos thumped his hand against the metal breastplate concealed beneath his tunic.
This is me we're talking about. I still had a few tricks up my sleeve, but virtually anyone else you would have beaten.
You've come a long way in a short time. Greg appreciated the praise, though he was also daunted by it. Sometimes he forgot this wasn't just for sport, like all those years of fencing lessons had been back in prep school. Now that he was a musketeer, knowing how to handle a sword could be the difference between life and death, especially when Michel Dinicoeur and Dominic Richelieu were out there somewhere, plotting against him. It had been 2 months since Michel had sprung Dominic from the Bastille. The attack had come mere minutes after Greg and the others had been sworn in as musketeers by King Louis XIII. Even though the Bastille was a massive protected fortress, it had proven a little challenge for Michel. The guards had claimed Michel had used sorcery, rendering men unconscious with a mere touch and making the walls explode with a single incantation. Once free, both men had ridden north of the city and crossed the Seine, and when the guards had tried to follow, they'd been repelled by a fusillade of arrows, courtesy of René Valois, a staunch supporter of Michel and Dominic, who had once been a leader of the King's Guard. By the time the musketeers arrived on the scene, Michel and Dominic were long gone. Greg still had no idea where they were, although he assumed they'd gone off to recover the Devil's Stone. Michel needed it to make his younger self, Dominic, immortal. For if Dominic died, then Michel would cease to exist. Greg wanted to find the stone just as badly as they did, perhaps more, for without it, he couldn't return to his own time. But now his enemies had a 2 month head start tracking it down, and once they had it, Greg suspected he'd never get it back. He and his parents would be trapped in 1615 France. Of course, there was always the possibility that Michel and Dominic hadn't gone after the stone at all, but were merely lurking about Paris, waiting for the best opportunity to kill Greg and the musketeers. a scenario Greg found equally unsettling. Therefore, Greg had spent the past 2 months doing two things, training with Athos and Porthos, or sleuthing with Aramis, the brains of the Musketeers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.